Thanks a lot for having me, and Gary for the invitation, and Stacia for all the great work with the logistics. Before I get started, I want to acknowledge support for this project from the Agricultural Technology Adoption Initiative, the UC Lab, and the International Growth Center. It's joint work with Ali Hassanan at the Lahore University of Management Sciences and Yasser Khan, who's a grad student at the Haas School of Business. So I want to start with a simple thought exercise. Imagine for a minute that you're a rural Pakistani farmer. You probably live on a couple of dollars a day, and you rely in a large part on agriculture for your livelihood. You have a couple of cows that provide you a constant stream of milk and calves that are going to make up either your primary or your secondary income source. Now imagine you wake up one morning and one of your cows is in heat. You need to get this cow inseminated right away so that it can continue to make milk and calves, but you're not going to have a bull in the house. It's not worth it to keep a bull because they don't produce milk and calves, but they take the same amount of resources. So you're going to rely on the market for artificial insemination. But like any other market for a service provision or a good, you have to decide which vet you're going to call for AI. Who do you think is going to provide you with high quality service at a price that is affordable for you? If this is the United States or most developed countries, we'd hop on our phones, we'd go on Yelp, we'd go on Angie's List, we'd go on any number of sites to look at ratings of different vets in our local area. This is exactly what we brought to rural Punjab, Pakistan. An information clearinghouse that crowdsources to citizens themselves the collection of information on the quality of local vets, aggregates this information to create vet ratings, and then provides this information back to these same households so they can make more informed decisions in the market for artificial insemination. And we do all of this is built around not smartphones, as it would be here, but dumb phones, because this is a setting where farmers, though they do have cell connection, which is awesome, they don't have a smartphone yet. In most cases, they're not literate. So we had to build all of this around a call center and essentially in-person conversations between agents in the right dialect and these farmers, which is why we don't have to make this look pretty. No one's actually looking at it. It's all being communicated over the phone. And so now let me take a step back and talk about what the motivation was for bringing this clearinghouse to rural Punjab, Pakistan. The main motivator here is one that's common in an economics, development economics seminar, which is asymmetric information between citizen principals and agents, leading to suboptimal outcomes. So these types of markets and suboptimal outcomes have been documented across the developed and the developing world, but it's one of the sort of hallmarks of the challenges we face in developing countries. And we can think about both government agents being those with asymmetric information and think about corruption, leakage, or just general shirking that has been well documented across the developing world. Or we can think about private agents and sort of the rent capture that we think about in agricultural markets in developing countries where middlemen and women essentially have more information about prices and use that to take advantage of farmers. Now, one solution to these types of asymmetric information is monitoring. It's to go out and measure the thing that citizens don't have and give them information on that. Measure performance, give citizens information on that. But monitoring is particularly costly in development context, country contexts. This is not just because of infrastructure and the fact that it's expensive to send someone out to rural Punjab, but also because these are areas where, because of political economy issues, patronage networks, and the likes, there's going to be a lot of folks who are going to push back when you go try to measure performance of government employees, for example. And this is going to raise the cost. You're going to have to create a system that's essentially can deal with these extra challenges you face. And crowdsourcing can make monitoring cost effective. So crowdsourcing can cut out the infrastructure challenge costs, because now, you know, if someone has a cell phone, you can get a hold of them, you can collect information from them or provide them with information. It also spreads out where you're getting information from and who you're giving information to, and makes it so that it's harder for the government employees or other folks to create bottlenecks in this process, as they're used to doing with sort of traditional bureaucratic processes. So with this motivation, we brought a cellular information clearinghouse to the context of government agent performance in Punjab, Pakistan. What exactly does this clearinghouse do? Well, it starts by measuring effort in what I'm going to argue is an important sector, which is the sector for livestock. I've already said why this is important for individual households. It's also an important sector for the country of Pakistan as a whole. Livestock agriculture accounts for about 12% of the GDP, and it's growing pretty rapidly as a share of GDP. It's been targeted by the government as a key growth sector. And artificial insemination is crucial to renewing livestock. Again, because houses can't or don't want to afford bulls, and also because there's an active breed selection program going on where the government is trying to selectively breed livestock to better produce milk, and this whole process requires artificial insemination. So the first step is to call farmers and ask them how good of a job their vets are doing after a service provision. And I'm going to say here we're measuring objective effort. And what do we mean by objective? I mean it's effort. Measuring whether or not an artificial insemination is successful is something that farmers all agree on what that means. So they all, you know, is my cow pregnant? There's a clear yes or no answer to that. And once you average over enough observations for a given vet so that you get rid of some of the noise from inherent variation in this process, then comparing a measurement of average AI success rate for one vet and the other, these are going to be directly comparable measures. So this is what I mean by objective. We're also going to measure prices that they charge on average. This is a setting where they can charge price, as well as a few other pieces of information. And now all of this information is going to be measured and continuously automatically aggregated in our clearinghouse to create veterinarian rankings. So literally we'll say veterinarian A has an average AI success rate of 80%, veterinarian B has an average AI success rate of 60%, and they charge the same price on average. And then this information is automatically disseminated to farmers, back to the same farmers who gave us information in the first place. And this last component we do as a randomized controlled trial that's going to allow us to evaluate the effectiveness of this information in this market. And I highlight here that we give this to farmers, not superiors. I think this is an important point to spend a minute on. So a lot of the previous work done in sort of development economics or political science or other literatures focused on monitoring and e-monitoring in these settings has been focused on sort of better monitoring performance within a bureaucracy. And some of my past work in Pakistan has done just that, where we measure doctor attendance and health inspector sort of performance, but then we give all that information just to those folks' bosses within the same bureaucracy. And this is what the sort of 2004 World Development Report would call the long round of accountability. And this is the report that sort of got people thinking about corruption and measuring corruption in developing country contexts. And the idea there is that sort of when you have citizen principles and they're being serviced by a government doctor, and then that doctor's boss's 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 boss is an elected official, if you can better get information up that chain of command, eventually you hit someone who's accountable to these citizen principles. We're taking what's called the short route of accountability here. We're cutting out all the middle bureaucracy. We're giving the information directly to the citizens themselves on performance and allowing them to change their behavior based on that information. And we're giving out local information using GPS, which is a cool thing we can do with the technology here. So it's akin to if you're looking on Yelp, you look by neighborhood rather than across all of LA. Here we're giving farmers information just on the vets, the rankings of the vets in their local area. Folks they could actually call and contract if they're interested.
Just thinking about, you know, I know you've thought about all the bottlenecks and so forth. I mean, were there farmers that were afraid to participate? You know, I don't know the culture in this, you know, where they might be afraid to tell you what actually is objective, because I think even though you tell them you're not going to report this, I think it still might come back to them one way or another. Should I worry about any of that? Or
yeah,
so because this is farmer to farmer, then there's not those issues at all.
No, it's farmer to government. Back to farmers, so we do have the government is part of this, and we partnered with them directly, and so farmers are having to first give information to the government livestock officers. So we worry a lot about this. I'll talk about it directly. The short answer is, sort of, farmers don't always respond, but nothing seems to predict that. So we're not finding that it's not something we're going to be worried about for our measuring our treatment effects, but also just in general, we end up with a pretty representative sample of farmers who, at the end of the day, give us information. And we collected in a couple of different sources, including independent surveys, which are not at all connected to the rest of the research and the implementation and the government, and we get very similar results there. So if farmers are systematically lying, it would have to be something that's really deep ingrained in them, not just quick response. Yes?
Two quick questions. Are all veterinarians government employees?
Great question, no. So this is a setting, it's essentially a private good that could be completely privately provided in this setting. There's some public good components, like the breed selection I talked about. The government has a couple of factories where they're trying to do this, and you need scale to do that. It's kind of a natural monopoly, but there are private veterinarians running around. We're only gonna be working with government veterinarians. We are gonna be able to see what happens when farmers switch between one or the other and what the market for private veterinarians looks like a little bit from our survey data. And the answer there is, there's not much going on from this intervention in the private market. And part of that is because they have a different customer. So we're gonna be focused on sort of small rural households with just a couple of livestock. The private AI folks tend to work with larger farms. Yeah.
But wouldn't there be a, just going back to the discussion, wouldn't there be an existing kind of a networking within the farmers that would disseminate this effectiveness of?
You'd hope, but we don't find that. And I'll actually give you some specific information that before we show up in the baseline, farmers essentially have no information about how good their local vets are. They can't, when we ask them, can you tell us on average how good your vet is? That what they tell us is not correlated with the truth at all. And that changes with our intervention. So for a number of reasons, and I have a slide on this, I don't think farmers are sharing this information or even aggregating within their own observations when they see repeated observations for a given vet. So I could talk in detail about why I think this is the case, but I think this is a general phenomenon within developing countries where sort of contracts are hard to make, information doesn't spread as fast as we'd like, and maybe that's changing with cell phones, but not as fast as some of these other things.
How is the GPS location incorporated into the clearinghouse if most farmers are using dumb phones?
So I'll talk about this, but the first initially we need farmers' phone numbers in order to then call them, and the point at which we're getting phone numbers is on a smartphone that all these government veterinarians are carrying. So they record when they provide a service, they take GPS coordinates, put the phone number in, that goes to our call center and generates phone calls and targeted information.
Okay, so you say you disseminate the ratings to them, does that mean the app doesn't give them that, they can't see that information just on the app?
So farmers don't have an app. There's no app for right. Citizens. The vets themselves have an app, but we don't give them information. We sort of made a once a month report to their boss saying, here's in general how folks are doing in your area. But we specifically wanted to give this information to farmers and not worry so much about what's going on with the vets. So just to preview the results, we're gonna find that this intervention has large impact. So farmers who received information on the ratings of their local veterinarian subsequently see a 27% increase in the likelihood that their cow gets pregnant, going from 62 to almost 80%. So essentially going from a very low percentage from what we'd understand in the science here to almost to the level we'd hope to expect. And similarly, farmers are more likely to come back to government vets in a market where they could choose between government and private vets. So this information is valuable and it's causing them to make choices at the intensive margin and at the extensive margin. And importantly, and I'm gonna end up talking a lot about this, the results are gonna be consistent with a model of moral hazard, which is to say that treatment is gonna induce increased veterinarian effort for the treated. So this is not gonna end up being a story about farmers switching to the better vets. We don't see any of that. Farmers stick with the same vets, but they see better service provision. So this is really more of a story, a moral hazard of these vets because there's asymmetric information essentially shirking from their job before we show up. And now when they're faced with someone who has this information, they can do a better job, and they do, in order to retain a customer. Now because of this, we can actually simplify the social welfare calculations because we don't have to worry about all the farmers trying to go to one vet and that vet getting overloaded and some potential negative consequences here. As long as we can kind of feel comfortable that the cost to vets of this increased effort isn't very high, then all the changes here are positive. And it turns out if you do some back of the envelope calculations, this intervention had a 300% return on the cost in terms of expected income gains for these households. And that's counting all the fixed costs of building this thing for the first time. So very substantial impact on the sort of everyday livelihoods of these folks.
Was it a relatively cheap thing to do?
Yes, yeah. I mean, so a majority of the costs going into this intervention were the fixed cost of hiring someone to build. I'm not a computer scientist, needed someone else to do that. Contracting the call center and setting up everything there so that it all worked, and we piloted this a bunch. The actual marginal cost of reaching a caller once you've got all this set up is pennies. So,
I mean, maybe you want to say anything before we get to this last question, which is actually kind of remarkable. If you didn't see people switching, then you wonder, well, why did they even adjust behavior?
Yeah, I'm going to talk a lot about that. Yeah, because this is something we wonder, sir, why, how, what behavior is being adjusted, and is that really what's happening here? Because it seems everyone kind of assumes we're going to see switching, and that's how it's going to work, because that's how we use Yelp in the U.S. But this is a setting where, for a number of reasons, I think this makes sense, and I'll talk through it a bunch of times. So now that was motivation. Let me talk a little bit more about the background about this market and why there's information asymmetries that exist, and it's not sort of working well to begin with. I'll talk a little bit more about this moral hazard versus adverse selection and what story, what type of asymmetric information goes on. And then I'll talk about our solution, the clearinghouse. Then the randomized controlled trial, the research design for that we built within the clearinghouse. Then I'll show results and conclude. So I hopefully convinced you that AI is an important sector in a place like Pakistan. Now I also want to convince you that it's a sector where asymmetric information is an important constraint for sort of optimal market functioning. So there's a couple of pieces of information that I think get at this. One, AI success is only observed here with a delay of 2 months. So right off the bat, a farmer can't pay a vet for the outcome of this service provision unless they can make a contingent contract in the future, and this is a setting where that's just not feasible for a number of reasons. Two, even when success is observed 2 months later, it's going to be hard from any one observation to observe veterinarian effort because there is inherent variability in this process from how the cow is doing in terms of its health to its age to the weather. There's a lot of things that can affect the likelihood of insemination. And so a farmer is not going to, even if their cow doesn't get pregnant and they see the vet 2 months later, it's going to be hard for them to argue that they should be paying less or whatnot. And at the same time, it's going to be hard for farmers to actually contract on the type of effort that would lead to the right outcome, which is maybe the next best thing you'd hope, because a lot of effort here is unobserved. And what's a good example of that? Here's a picture of a semen straw, this blue straw, that's used in artificial insemination. These straws are produced by the government in one of two centers in Punjab and sent to these government vets every so often in liquid nitrogen containers. They have to be kept at sub-zero temperatures all the way up until the point just a couple minutes before insemination. And essentially there's a lot of opportunity for these vets to just not pay as much attention as they should or to take a semen straw out of these containers for a reason that they shouldn't be and for essentially the semen to die. And anecdotally they know this happens a lot and they still go use that straw because otherwise they're gonna have to pay the 50 cents back to the government for it. So this is exactly the type of effort that's unobserved and can lead to really poor outcomes with little effort or a lack of effort. So with all of these facts, this is a setting where if we show up at baseline, there's a couple of sort of key pieces of information that I think summarize the level of asymmetric information. One, as I already mentioned, there's no correlation between farmers' expectation about the success of their current vet. So we say how often out of 10 do you think your vet is successful at AI? And we know the truth sort of on average of that vet from our clearinghouse. These things aren't correlated. So farmers don't know they have a 70% vet or a 50% vet, and there is variation there. So it's not just that they're all guessing right at the mean. They're just completely off. At the same time, there's no correlation between the price that a vet's charging on average and their success rate. So it's not the case that farmers talk to each other and they know who the best vet is, and they kind of are willing to pay a little bit more to get that vet, which is what we would expect if this market was working properly. Price and success rate, average success rate are not correlated. At the same time, price today is not correlated with success in the past for farmers that see the same veterinarian repeated times. So this just kind of gets back at saying it's really hard to make a contingent contract in this setting because you'd expect that maybe if you keep seeing the same vet and last time they weren't successful, they'd give you a discount this time. We see no evidence of that. So this is really a setting where asymmetric information exists and it seems to be pretty prevalent. Now, what type of asymmetric information or what model should we be using to think about this asymmetric information? This is an important thing to think about up front because it would have important implications for how we think about policies to address this asymmetric information. So we observe at baseline a lot of veterinarian shirking. And by that, I just mean average AI success rates are much lower than we'd expect, given the technology being used and the training of these individuals. We also observe less shirking with monitoring. And so this is just the fact that AI success rates increase on average when we show up. Now, these two facts could be sort of consistent with either unobserved agent effort, so a story of moral hazard, or inherent agent ability, or a story of adverse selection. And so the idea could be that maybe it's the fact that agents actually, there's a variation in their quality, and it's essentially a lemons market, where because the good ones can't signal that appropriately, they're not able to charge the full price, and then everyone kind of puts in a low quality. Or it could be that everyone has the same ability, and just because of asymmetric information, given their bargaining position with a given farmer, they're going to put in as little effort as they can.
Does the government set the price of a legal agent, or just say it's for this profession?
So you mean the price of providing service provision? So there's a minimum price, which is the cost of the semen, 50 cents essentially. And then agents are allowed to charge a show-up fee on top of that. The courts have ruled because they have to travel to farms. It's too expensive for farms to bring cows, and they have to pay for gas and other things. So this essentially gives them a free range to charge a fee to show up. So in that sense, it's almost a quasi-private. So they're government agents. They are never going to get fired. They're never going to get transferred. Their jobs are very secure. But they also are able to collect some rents from their service provision.
And do you have data on different vets charging essentially different show-up fees in the same geographies?
Yeah, so there's a lot of variation, both within a vet and across vets and across time. I mean, there's plenty of variation within the price. And we're going to see some movement on it from results as well.
I'll get back to Tridib's point, too. I mean, just about the networks. Like, if you heard that your neighbor was charged twice as much as you, you'd be, what's going on?
Yeah. So I think
it's not about effectiveness. It's about at least the price is observable today as opposed to 2 months from now.
Yeah. So it's quite possible that that's happening. I think it's not very common. And this is not actually something people talk about a lot. I mean, this is another thing that has to do with AI. So livestock are essentially cared for by women in most of these households, but AI is the one thing because it's insemination that it's done by the men. So there's sort of a disconnect and the information doesn't travel as well in this setting as you'd expect. So I don't even think households are having that conversation. But the extent that they are, that would just be weakening the type of results, the sort of standard spillover story. And we cluster our standard errors and do all the econometric things to worry about that. So the big key here and the way we're going to distinguish between these two stories is that we don't observe farmers switching. And so vets across the board are able to improve their effort when faced with the farmer that has more information. This tells us at least it can't be pure adverse selection. It has to be a story that's more about moral hazard, or at least a big part of it is moral hazard. And so that's something I think important to think about as I go through the rest of this. Now, how did we address moral hazard with this clearinghouse? Here's a flow chart of the clearinghouse. It has four main components. I'm going to talk through them one at a time. So first, we partnered with the Punjab Livestock and Dairy Development Department, the provincial government in Pakistan, to have all of the government vets in one district of Punjab, Saival, carry around a smartphone. And they were required every time they provided an AI service to record that service provision in the smartphone in an app that we built. And that information would get automatically and in real time sent to our dashboard. And now this would generate two phone calls automatically through the connected call center. First, the next day we'd call every farmer and say, you know, verify that service provision happened as it was recorded and ask them how much they paid for the service provision. So while it's fresh on their mind. And then 60 days later, they'd get a second call asking them, simple question, did your cow get pregnant? Yes or no? And this information then automatically connects to the incoming information from the smartphone app in the clearinghouse and just continues to aggregate in real time. So we ran just these two components of the clearinghouse for about 10 months before we started giving out any information, because we really wanted to make sure we had good measures of vet average success and average prices charged so that we weren't giving bad information out. And once we had run this for 10 months and believed these measures that we had created, we then switched on treatment. which was essentially a stratified coin flip at the point when we were already talking to farmers on the phone, deciding if we wanted to give them additional information. So we, you know, we just added a little module onto the end of the phone calls where we would say, thanks a lot for providing us with this information. Now we want to provide you with some information that you may find useful. Are you interested? Everybody says yes. And then the last component of this clearinghouse is the fact that we're able to identify farmers over time through their phone numbers, a pretty unique identifier in this case. So we can then track if this same farmer shows up later after we treat them in the same system for another service provision. And so we're going to have a panel data set to, on which to understand the impacts of giving out this information. And this is all built in from the start. So as far as the timeline goes, we began in November 2013 with the smartphone app recordings. 2 months later, we started phone calls. And then we ran that for 10 months until October 2014. Then the treatment period was from October to the end of June of 2015.
Is there any variation in the quality of the semen in terms of what the offspring and milk and all those kinds of things? Or is that standardized?
In this setting, it's standardized because there are literally just two factories that are producing the semen for all of this. And everybody's getting the same canisters, and the supply chain there is pretty weak, so I don't think they're able to figure out what's going where to any level of accuracy. There are other qualities of semen running around, but mainly in the private market, and they're much more expensive for sort of higher end consumers. So now let me talk about the research design, the randomized controlled trial component that we built into this clearinghouse and how we wanted to evaluate the effectiveness of this information. So first, let me tell you a little bit more about the information. So specifically, the information we gave out to treated farmers was the ratings of the top three veterinarians within a 3 kilometer radius of their village, so very local, in terms of average AI success rate weighted between cows and buffalo, which are just the main two breeds of livestock in this setting, of cow livestock. For each of these three vets, we gave out three pieces of information: average AI success, average prices charged, and the number of observations we used to make these averages. So this is akin to the same three pieces of information you'd see on Yelp for a restaurant, right? The number of stars, the number of dollar signs, and the number of reviews. And we sent an SMS follow-up to each of these households as soon as we got off the phone with these 9 pieces of information in the event that folks wanted to recall them later and they had someone alerted in the household that could read the SMS, which is not a given. Now, I want to take a minute to show that this treatment assignment we did, so it was essentially in real time automatic coin flip, so it was kind of a fun way to do treatment. I'm happy to talk about that offline, but to make sure that we were balanced on between treatment and control and all of our observable characteristics, just to make sure that the randomization was done properly. The short answer is it was. And the two other things I want to take away from this picture, one, this is all the information that our app and calls were collecting. This is it. The app was very short. The phone calls were very short. We were very conscious about not wasting people's time and about trying to keep their attention. So we piloted this. We had a much longer app and a much longer set of questions we wanted to ask, and we shortened to just what we thought was the key information. And I think that's really important for these types of interventions. Of course, we're not going to have that much information to say a lot for our evaluation, so we're also going to do a survey of a representative sample of households to have much more rich information for those households. The other thing I want to talk about, which came up earlier, is the fact that this is a potentially selected sample. So in order to end up in the clearinghouse, first a vet has to go provide you a service and record that in their app, and no one's forcing them to do it. We made it a job requirement for them, but no one's looking over their shoulder at all times. Then the farmer has to answer the phone twice and give us information, and then the farmer has to be visited again by a vet who again records the service provision in an app in order for us to have a post-treatment observation. So there's reason to believe that at any of these levels, there could be selection along at, say treatment by treatment status, which would bias our treatment effect estimation. So we're gonna worry a lot about that. And this is part of the reason we collected a baseline and endline survey in this setting of a representative sample of households. So we did the baseline before we started any of our activities, and then line sort of concurrent with wrapping this up. In a representative sample of 90 villages, across about out of about 500, and this is the district scalable. In each village, we surveyed 10 households. And for those who are wondering, this is where scalable is within all of Pakistan and within the province of Punjab. It's pretty representative of Punjab, actually. We have some pretty good data on this, and it looks like the average district in the province. And so the first thing we can do with this data is verify that selection, at least in a way that's gonna hurt us for internal validity, is not a problem with our clearinghouse sample. So here what we're doing is comparing these independently reported cases of AI provision by a government officer. So when our surveyors show up, they're not connected to the government or the other components of this project, and they ask households whether they got AI recently. And then we can compare that directly with the clearinghouse to see which gets reported. Sort of two things arise. One, only about 30% of the time do vets actually record when they provide a service. So they're not doing a great job across, in general. But it doesn't seem like they're doing it differentially by treatment or control farmer. So they're not sort of smart at this stage within 7 or 8 months, they didn't get smart in terms of understanding that maybe they should only record when they're seeing a treatment farmer or a better or worse service provision. None of these things are correlated with whether or not they submitted a report. Just sometimes they do their job, sometimes they don't. Then we might also worry about farmer response bias. So the fact that farmers have to answer the phone and give us information to end up in this database. So we could think about squeaky wheels or folks who want to just complain, and those are the people that are more likely to answer the phone and talk through a 5-minute conversation, or it could, in theory, be the reverse. And we don't find any evidence of this as well. So when we compare our clearinghouse sample to our representative survey sample, where we made sure there was no margins of selection, we see that the average farmer AI success rate is the same in the two samples. So it's not farmers who are, on average, having better successes or worse successes that seem to be answering the phone. So these two pieces of information convince us that we can sort of rely on the clearinghouse data to do our analysis. And the reason we like that is because we have more power there. But we also repeat all of our analysis on a representative sample, and it all holds. So I could show you any of that if anyone is interested. The other thing we can do with the survey is actually verify that this information treatment worked. So this first panel shows you the correlation between vets' actual average AI success rate and farmers' expectations in the baseline when we asked them. So this I already told you was zero. This is what the scatter plot looks like. And now the second panel is the same question we ask in the end line after farmers, for treated farmers, after they've been told what the average quality of their vet is. And it turns out now those things become much more correlated. So farmers are, when we tell them and then we show up, someone else shows up a few months later and asks them about the quality of their vet, they remember a lot better than they did before what their vet's average quality is. And we don't see the same story in the control farmers, which implies that there's a lot, not necessarily a lot of information sharing going on in this environment during this period. It's a weak positive in the controls, but not significant. So now we've seen that sort of we can, at least as far as we can tell, trust this data that's coming in through this system. And we've seen that people seem to change their expectations about the quality of their vet. So now the question is, how do they change their actual behavior and how do outcomes change?
Is there any statistical differences? Notice even the inline control did have it trend upward. I don't know if this is.
Yeah, no, it's not statistically significant. And it's also, it's a pretty noisy sample. So this we can only do with our survey data, which is less powered. So it's possible that it is there, and that would be fine from the perspective of then it would be information spillovers, but nothing we can distinguish here from zero. Though the line in the middle one is highly significant, and it's 0.9 coefficient. So what specification do we use? A standard sort of post-treatment, average treatment effect specification, where we're going to regress one of four outcomes on a dummy for treatment, and a vector of controls for precision, is what, including straight of fixed effects. And then we're going to cluster our standard errors at a pretty conservative level of village clusters in case there's any geographic spillovers in the way these outcomes are occurring because of disease or the way the semen is distributed or whatnot. We have four primary outcomes. The first three I'm going to call sort of the intensive margin, and the last one is extensive margin. So at the intensive margin, first we have do farmers switch vets conditional on coming back to a government vet after they've been treated, or would have been treated if they're a control farmer. Second, price. What was the price paid by these farmers? Third, AI success rate. Did their cows get pregnant or not? And fourth, at the extensive margin, are farmers, do they come back at all to a government veterinarian? So this is a setting where they could sort of leave the clearinghouse and this system to go to a private veterinarian. And of course, we can observe this in our survey sample.
But what about switching to a different vet?
That's, so switching within government is our first outcome. Switching from a government to a private, or in theory, deciding they want to leave the AI market and go to natural insemination, which is an option, it's expensive, would all be captured in the extensive margin. So on to results. I'll break it up by the first three outcomes and then extensive margin, just for no real reason. So at the intensive margin, here's our main result in a picture. So this is average AI success rate over time for treatment versus control farmers. So prior to November 2014 or October 2014, everyone is a control farmer. And so this, you're just seeing sort of what our system is picking up from just those first two components. And then after October 2014, we switch on treatment and we can look at how the average success rate for treated farmers versus control farmers look over time. So a few things to take away from this picture, other than the fact that there's a large treatment effect, which I'll talk about. One, there seems to be a lot of other stuff going on, right, at the same time or during this period. And I think that's just an important reminder that all of this we're doing can improve success rates, but there's also a lot of other macro stuff happening. So why I think there's a downward trend happening in general during this period is because there was essentially a big transition in the leadership in the livestock department, and everybody was just less motivated and doing a worse job during this period. And we had to deal with that, which is part of the reason we stopped the project when we did. So it doesn't surprise me that these types of trends are happening. And of course, they're not going to hurt our results as long as the trends are the same in treatment and control, but it's interesting. The other interesting thing we see here, which I've had a lot of fun talking to vets about, is this bump up early on for the control farmers in terms of their average AI success rates. So we didn't give farmers, we didn't tell them we were going to give this information out. They knew we were collecting information, and we were giving little reports to their boss once a month. But the day we switched on this treatment, they had no idea what was happening. And anecdotally, a lot of them just started freaking out when they met the first farmer who said, "Oh, hey, I heard you're not as good as I thought you were." And so then they started doing a better job for everybody. But then these guys are smart and they want to protect their time and they're used to doing that. So they figured out after a short amount of time that, wait, only half the farmers I see are hassling me. So if I don't get hassled, why should I improve? And we see this sort of, if anything, the treatment effect is getting larger over time, that we're not powered to distinguish sort of a break in trends here. And so if we subtract the red line from the blue line, we can get an average treatment effect over time. And
so what happened to the treatment after March?
So the big bump up.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I don't have standard error bars on here because it gets ugly, but we have a lot less data near the end. So I don't really want to interpret anything that's happening right at the end. It could just be sort of noisier estimate there. But it also could be that the livestock department is starting to turn around and certain people who are already getting monitored respond more. I have some other work on this type of stuff. So here's the average treatment effect over time. And we see that it's, you know, hovers between about 5 and 20 percentage points. And that even when we're sort of bootstrapping standard errors at the month by month level, it's significant a lot of the times, this difference. Now, if we take it to a regression and average across all of these months, in column 3, we see that this averages out to a 17 percentage point increase in the likelihood of livestock becoming pregnant for treated farmers relative to control. And on a base of 62%, that's a 27% increase in the likelihood of their cow getting pregnant. The other two things we see here, one is this result I've mentioned a bunch of times, farmers don't switch vets when they're given this information, any more than control farmers. And they're not switching very often, about 8% of the time in this sample. Two, we see it's a pretty weak, but it's there, and it can, in some specifications, it's significant evidence that prices decrease for these same farmers. And the p-value there is 0.12, so take it with a grain of salt, but it would be consistent with the story that farmers are essentially, this information gives them more bargaining power with these vets in this moral hazard framework, and they're able to bargain sort of along two dimensions, price and effort. And both of these then are going in the same direction we'd expect. On the extensive margin, I already previewed this, but farmers are going to be essentially 33% more likely to come back to government vet before the end of our intervention when they are given this information. And this is consistent with the fact that these farmers are, we're giving them valuable information that's valuable in one market and not another. And so they're, you know, if a restaurant's on Yelp, you're more likely to go there versus one that you have no information about maybe. Of course, you might be worried about this because this is another word for this would be essentially treatment-driven attrition, because we're seeing more treatment farmers show up in the data afterwards than control farmers. And so we do a lot in the paper to worry about this, and it turns out it's not as much of a worry. So you can use the survey data to look at the sample, including those that attrit, and we still get the same result, or you can do this sort of standard stuff of doing a balanced test between those who come back for government services and those who leave, and nothing seems to predict it. It's just some people come back more than they would have otherwise. So now onto the mechanism, which is getting at really, can we pin down, or how well can we pin down what is actually happening here? Why this AI success rate is increasing and sort of who's changing their behavior in this environment. So I'm gonna present four results that suggest this is really about veterinarians increasing their effort. The first I've already mentioned a bunch of times, farmers aren't switching vets, yet they see improvements. So right off the bat, it can't be from sort of a resorting that we're seeing this impact. It has to be from either farmers changing their behavior or vets changing their behavior. Now, in theory, farmers could change their behavior in ways that improve this likelihood of AI success. So they can treat their cows better, and they could sort of just generally negotiate with vets differently once they learn that there's a distribution of success, which maybe they didn't know before. But we find two results that kind of go against this. First, farmers that were given information on the rankings of their local government vets and then switch to private vets don't see better outcomes. So if there was something about just learning about that there is a distribution of quality and price, you'd think that would carry over even when farmers go into the private market. And we see no evidence of that. And third, we see this, you know, it's weak, but it's consistently there, this decrease in prices. And this is only consistent with some change in behavior between the farmer and the vet, because prices are negotiated between the two of them. It's not set. And so there has to be some movement on the vet side for us to see any movements in prices. Last, we see that effects are largest for farmers who are essentially given worse news about their vet. And this is consistent with this bargaining story that farmers who essentially are given more novel information are able to leverage that more. And so here, now these results I'm gonna call exploratory because we lose a lot of power when we start breaking it up this way. But on the top panel, we have farmers that whose vet was in the top three within 3 kilometers. And on the bottom panel, we have farmers whose vet was not in the top three. And there's, on average, about 6 government vets within this 3 kilometer radius. So you can think of it as sort of above and below median vet quality. And our results are really, at least, you know, in these noisy estimates, being driven by the ones whose vet was not in the top three. So it seems like farmers who find out their vet's pretty good, they just continue business as usual. Farmers who find out their vet is really bad are the ones who then see, you know, much lower prices, not significant, and much higher AI success rates. And this really fits with the story of moral hazard, that it's for these individuals that vets are able to improve the most. And of course, the vets in this bottom group are much worse on average, about 50% success rate for control vets. So they have a lot of room to improve as well. We can also break this up by farmers' expectations. So whether we know what they, in the representative survey data, we know how surprised they were when they learned their vet's quality based on their own expectations. So these things aren't correlated at baseline, but some farmers thought their vet was better than they were actually in truth, and some farmers thought their vet was worse they were in truth. Those results, if anything, are even stronger. Farmers that are more shocked about a negative quality shock for their vets see larger increases.
Yeah, so I'm still just trying to kind of think, I don't know the culture well. Mm-hmm. And so in getting such a negative piece of information that your vet is one of the bottom or something like that, again, I would think, oh, well, I'm going to find a better vet.
Yeah.
But here, it sounds like your story is that it's about negotiation. Like maybe the farmer then tells the vet, you did not do well.
Yeah.
So then are they shamed into doing better? And that's expected that they will do better? or is there another mechanism?
Yeah, that's a great question. So the answer from what I have here is, you know, we can't, beyond anecdotes, which I have a lot of, we have no way to separate those in the data. We actually went back and did follow-up phone calls with a bunch of farmers and asked them sort of open-ended questions about what they did with this information. And we find a lot of anecdotes consistent, which I haven't put this in, and we're going to put it into the paper, but consistent with the fact that this really is about changing the negotiations. Why it is that farmers aren't switching vets in a setting where they suddenly find out there's a better vet in their area, I think there's a couple of reasons why it would make sense for farmers to give at least a second chance to their current vet before they switch. Okay. I mean, the main reason is that switching costs here are high for a number of reasons. One, you know, we know in development context that a lot of folks are risk averse, and a lot of them have been going with the same vet for some amount of time, so there's just going to be a cost to them to switching and taking on a new risk. So they know their vet. They may not know their vet success rate, but they know the person. They know they'll answer the phone. They know they'll show up on time, which is really important for the service because you only have one day, really, when
the
cows.
If they are in treatment, do they get offered the ratings of all vets or just their own?
Just the top three in their local area, everybody got. They could ask about a specific vet, and we would look it up for them on the spot. So if they wanted to compare against some other vet that they'd heard of, we'll let them do that. No one really asks for that information. Most of them just take what we give them. But we actually measure that in the data as well, and those farmers don't seem to be any more sophisticated along anything else we can measure. So just sometimes they have a name and they ask. Right. And we allowed actually farmers even to call in to the clearinghouse if they wanted to just collect information. No one really took that service on either. Yep.
So in terms of this negotiation process, is there any indication that providing the farmers with this information, particularly the ones that have the bad vets, would give them the perception that they can, A, turn this into kind of a leverage in the negotiation, but also that the other vets are de facto going to be more expensive, so that would deter them from switching? Like, because they know that their vet is not as good, therefore he can be, kind of the price can be negotiated down, and it doesn't make any sense to switch because the other ones are going to be better no matter and more expensive no matter what.
Yeah, I mean, this gets at what I was just saying to Gary. I mean, there's a lot of anecdotes and sort of more structured ones through qualitative interviews that suggest that farmers do understand this information is valuable for negotiation. So I think that's true. The exact mechanism of sort of, is this about the fact that they think their vet can do a better job, or do they think this vet will charge them less? I mean, we see empirical evidence that both of those things are happening at the same time. So, you know, I think that fits the story you just described. But why it is, if they found out that there's a really good, really cheap vet in their area, they don't switch to that vet. That gets more at the sort of story about switching costs, the cost of actually switching being pretty high in this setting as well. And that I can sort of talk through more detail if anyone is interested. Yep.
So you've talked about the farmers and the vets, but what about the cows? does this assume that all cows are equal in their susceptibility to impregnation? Maybe some cows just don't get pregnant as easy.
Yeah, so I mean, this is why we ran this for 10 months, just collecting information. So the average AI success rates, I really believe, and those are sort of average across. You'd have to worry that some vets see a different distribution of cow types than other vets. And so systematically, if one vet sees all the tough cows to impregnate and one vet sees all the easy cows, this would cause us a problem in the way we're measuring this. But short of that happening, on average, these vets are gonna see one healthy cow, one sick cow, whatnot. Now, for a given farmer, in a given negotiation, if they have a really sick cow and they're trying to get it impregnated, that's definitely at play in the way these folks are talking about it. So these are all averages. And there is a distribution of prices and success rates that's healthy in this setting. So just to start wrapping up, one, just a reminder, we found that farmers treated with information on the ratings of their local veterinarians subsequently saw a 27% increase in the likelihood that their cows would get pregnant, and were 33% more likely to come back to a government provider for AI. When we do cost-benefit analysis, this comes out in expectation to about $32 in expected income for this household. And this is a really conservative calculation that's just based on the fact that now a household is essentially 20 percentage points more likely to have a cow born this month a calf born or sort of a cow impregnated this month versus 2 months of now from now. So their whole stream of future calves is 2 months sooner. And in expectation, given that cows are very valuable in this setting, that translates to about $32. I mean, one female calf at market is about a year's median income in this setting. So it's their primary asset. And the cost to reaching each of these farmers is about $8. And that's all inclusive of fixed costs. And as I already mentioned, most of this is fixed costs. And we ran this so we know exactly how much it costs. And sort of the marginal cost is literally pennies once we have this thing up and running. So these costs will decrease with any sort of scale up. And you can think about scale up similar types of interventions, scaling up both sort of across within livestock. And this is something we've been working on with some policy briefs and the like in Pakistan. It's a tough time that they switch livestock secretaries to some guy who is not a fan of everybody. And for some reason, he's been there longer than the usual secretary is. So we're working on that. But we've also been thinking about, you can easily think about scaling this into really any sector in which people are able to measure something that, you know, one observation is not going to be that helpful, but aggregating those observations can be helpful. Now, in our setting, we were kind of lucky. We had an objective measure of effort. You don't always get that. Sometimes you're going to have to use more subjective measures or think very carefully about what you're measuring. We also had a setting where these were government agents, but they were able to charge a price. You don't always get that. With teachers, they're not supposed to be charging a price. They might be in various ways. But in general, I think you can think of a lot of settings where this type of intervention would be helpful. So I've done past work with doctors in Pakistan, but again, there we are more focused on within the bureaucracy. We haven't tried anything sort of focused on citizens themselves. You can think about police. This is something that's a hot issue in Pakistan and across the developed world, which is police transparency and accountability these days. And sort of everything police do is pretty observable if you can aggregate it in the proper way. And or you can think about milkmen. In Pakistan, they're all men. I piloted a project where we actually, in Lahore, in an urban area, we measured milk quality using some simple instruments and gave this information out to citizens. It turns out in that setting, it didn't work as well. And part of that was because there was less variation in quality than we expected going in. So, you know, this isn't something that can solve every problem. Or if there's no problem to solve, then there's no problem to solve.
Well, the police would be incredibly important, obviously, here as well.
Yeah.
You know, in terms of the behavior around arrests and the systematic variations across race and ethnic groups that we observe and have observed, but yet there's not been a study to think about what kinds of interventions, right? It's, you know, they're positing more training and these kinds of things, right? That could be one, but this is a very simple one where the White House Police Data Initiative was trying to just put the data out there, then that might change. Huh?
Yeah. Yeah. And so, I mean, this gets at, I could talk a lot about how I think an intervention like that could be successful. This is something I think a lot about these days. I mean, I think that there's some challenges with police. I mean, one is not all information is public, and some of the most important information isn't. It's a lot maybe more expensive to collect. But another thing in that setting is just or to think about is what the right information is. And I think this is the challenge in a lot of these settings. We had to really narrow down what information we were focused on and think about one thing. And there's some people that are doing this with police for something such as, you know, killing of unarmed people. There's a lot of these sort of accountability websites out there. But if you want particular data on race and ethnicity or how it's tied to immigration or how it's tied to other outcomes or sort of behavior, then I don't think anything exists. And we could think about how to make something that's appropriate for the right audience. And so I want to sort of tie up this point I was just making earlier, that this is a setting where I think it's pretty exciting that crowdsource monitoring increases effort, even in a setting with very limited accountability and thin markets. So these are government employees. They're never going to get fired. This is this area where patronage is rife, and so they're not going to even get transferred from their job. Most of their salary is very secure. Yet these sort of small information interventions can induce large impacts, much larger than we've seen in the literature from sort of direct incentives for these types of folks, say. And this is also an area with thin markets. So it's not the case, though there is an active market for AI here, this switching costs are high. And it's not easy for households to switch around. And this should give more power to the vets. But it's still more, you know, more information, and removing some of this asymmetric information is able to shift that power towards the households quite a bit. Maybe not all the way, but quite a bit. And the real hero is, of course, the fact that all of these households have a phone now. And they'll give you their phone number, they'll answer the phone when you call. Right? This is something that is a phenomenon that's very new and very important in these contexts. It's also a phenomenon that creates a lot of challenges.
So first of all, I find this study really fascinating. I wonder if you could speak a little bit about the staying power of information for long-term behaviors and social dynamics. In other words, how dependent is this type of change on the continued intervention? Let's say if you can't maintain the clearinghouse, from your experience, do you think that people would revert to, you know, the previous types of negotiation practices or dynamics that they had? Or once they know that they can have, or what they've had access to information, does it change their relationships with the vets? And do you think this could just kind of have a path dependency moving forward? Yeah,
that's a great question. So the short answer is I can't answer that in this context. Because we didn't do a sort of, it would be interesting to show up today, now that this hasn't been going on for a year, and see if there's still a treatment effect. And that, in theory, we could do that if we went and sought funding for that. And I thought about something like that. But we didn't do any follow-up after we turned the program off, so we thus far can't answer that question. I will say that, you know, in the development, economic, and political economy literatures, we do see systematically that these things tend to unravel over time. There's staying power is weak. And that's why, actually, one reason I think these types of platforms that can be cheaply run forever are pretty cool, because then you don't have to worry about shutting it off once you get it going and enough people are using it. Even if not everybody's using it, even if not every vet is recording, if it's big enough, it may be self-sustaining. And I'm working on doing this type of stuff in Pakistan right now. The other thing is, sort of from a theoretical perspective, can you sort of get from a low equilibrium to a high equilibrium? It from sort of giving a bunch of information at one stage. And theoretically, that's totally possible. I'm actually working on this with another colleague in a slightly different context, but writing some theory around this. So I think in theory it's possible, but we haven't seen it very often in real life.
Maybe you mentioned this and I missed it, but I'm curious, did you see any change in behavior by the people who oversaw the veterinarians?
So that's a good question. There's not very many. So these vets sort of respond just, I'm calling them vets, but their technical title is artificial insemination technician. And then there's two vets who are in the entire district, their boss, one for each of the sub-districts. And then those two vets report to one person. So there's three people above them within a district. And I will talk in a sec about another project where we are much more careful about looking at how bureaucrats respond. And it's very interesting stuff. In this setting, we weren't too focused on that. We did survey those individuals, but we don't see, other than a general pushback from them on what we were doing, we don't see anything. But we didn't have a large enough sample there. We would have to do a province-wide type of intervention to have the power there to understand changes in just a few people.
Were they getting the information?
So we were sending them a monthly, like, physical compliance report. They didn't have access to the dashboard, so they weren't getting it in real time. They were just sort of, we sent them a graph that said success by vet over time and prices chart. So they kind of had the same information, but more static, in a static form. Was there another question?
Maybe I missed it. You followed up with the farmers. Did you follow up to get any information from the technicians, the vets, about their behavior change?
Yeah, so we surveyed them all. We did baseline and inline surveys for them all and some focus groups at the beginning and at the end. And I don't present it here, but most of the convincing evidence is on the anecdote side. It's vets sort of talking about how this affected them, and everything is consistent with the story I told you. In terms of, is there differential response by certain vets, and can we predict which vets are better or worse? All of that is more secondary to the main treatment effect, so I haven't not talked about it here.
They didn't give you a sense that they changed.
They complained a ton. Right, for example, right? They hated this. Right.
About what?
They hated this. So, you know, their bosses loved it. They hated it. and they grumbled about it, but they did it, you know, somewhat of the time. And they, we know sort of administratively how we can look very detailed at when they're doing reports and where, and if there is anything fishy going on there. We don't see any evidence of that. So it just seems to be for vets, this is a thing that they don't like because they're losing revenue, but they have to do it. So they do it at sort of as minimum as they can, and they do it in the way that helps them best. They're optimizing just like the farmers are. That's what our results suggest. But similar to the higher ups, we don't have a huge sample of vets. There's only about 75 of them in this district, so we can't do really fine grained stuff there or even split it up much at all. Yep.
How do you guarantee that the farmer is going to trust you? So how do you guarantee that, like, the information that you're providing to them is information that they're going to trust? What? How do you prove to them that you're, like, a legitimate source? If you popped up, you were there for a year and a half, 2 years. How does that work?
Well, so we don't, you know, we can't prove that they trusted us. There was some response, so they were using that information. But in this case, we did partner with the government, so the person calling them on the phone call was the government. So that actually could be a reason, and I've done some research on this, on sort of trust in government and how that might be changing here. We tried to measure that, but it doesn't seem like there's a lot of movement there. So it's not the case that this is making people trust government more or less. They seem to be fairly trusting in livestock, so they're not in other parts of government, like military or whatnot. But livestock, they seem to be fairly trusting, and that stays through intervention. But what would have happened if we did this ourselves? I don't know. This is a nice thing about working directly with the government. And one of the cool things about working in a place like Pakistan, where the government is pretty accessible and excited about these types of projects. And on that note, let me talk for a few minutes about some of the sort of new interventions and challenges that sort of the new challenges that are either created or highlighted from these types of interventions that I don't think we've thought about because we never had to, because the big problems like asymmetric information were the binding ones. So one is this false reporting. Can we get vets to tell the truth? So in our case, the way we verify that they're sort of not systematically false reporting is by surveying a whole bunch of farmers. That's very expensive. If we put that into the cost-benefit analysis, this would look much worse. So you can't afford to do that for every intervention. And so one sort of exciting area of research that I'm working on is the idea of e-audits. So I'd call this an e-monitoring intervention. E-audits essentially says, let's take machine learning or other types of techniques to try to predict just from the data coming in, who's lying, who's falsifying reports, who's doing more or less than they say they are. And if you, you know, really start to get enough data in, you can do a pretty good job of these predictions, and then you can send out targeted auditors and essentially do it the way the IRS does in the US to try to catch tax evaders. Very much target this because it's an expensive process. And we're doing this, we're piloting this with government vaccinators in Pakistan right now. Now let's say you actually believe the data that's coming in. In a lot of these cases, you're suddenly gonna have more data than you know what to do with. And this is actually a problem in the sense that you can't just throw all this data out there. You have to think very carefully about what data you want to measure and which data you want to give out. And one cool example of this is from a previous project I did with measuring or sort of monitoring doctor attendance and health inspector inspections in Punjab. So here we were collecting information through a smartphone app on performance of doctors and health inspectors and providing that to senior health officials. So folks who are pretty senior in the health department and whose job it is to oversee an entire district of a couple million people, the health service delivery to those individuals. So we provided them with an actual dashboard that they could log into on their laptops whenever they wanted to. But if we just put all of, and these are facility reports. So this is an inspector went and inspected a facility, and was the MO, the medical officer, the doctor, absent or present? And other staff, were they absent or present? That's the thing we're most interested in. And it turns out if you just throw all this information at a senior health official, they're busy, they're overwhelmed, they don't do anything with it. If you do something as simple as highlighting some of these reports in red for underperforming facilities, and we did this as an experiment, then they suddenly actually pay attention to these highlighted red reports and they make phone calls and they ensure greater attendance of doctors in these areas in the future. So this is the type of thing you have to think a lot about in these settings. And we already knew this going into the livestock project, so we spent a bunch of time piloting this and thinking about what information was going to be helpful and how much information. But I think this is actually can end up being a problem. I've seen a lot of this with excitement in Pakistan by the government to just let's go, you know, do everything, e-monitor everything. But you end up, you know, you can, if you don't take the time to pilot and understand what information people can use and will use, you run into problems. And there's some cool research opportunities here too. Third, when you're thinking about government public service provision, a lot of the goods being provided are public goods, and so you have collective action problems. So pollution is a good example in a project I'm working on where we're essentially giving pollution monitors or pollution monitor readings to rural industrial households in villages in Punjab. So now suddenly they're finding out how polluted their village is, and they know which factory is doing the polluting, but this is then now a classic public good, and there's going to be a collective action problem. So we're actually going and building a collective action type intervention, which there's been some successful ones in development economics in places like Uganda, and trying to see if information plus sort of a collective action type treatment can allow folks this information to have impacts in public good spaces. And lastly, there's still a last mile problem in these settings. So I frame this by talking about the fact that everyone has a cell phone. That's not true. As we know, if you've sort of followed Zuckerberg or other people's press releases lately, there's still a large, about 10% of the world's population still doesn't have cell access. And these are the areas that are probably never gonna get it under the current sort of systems because they're remote, it's very expensive to go put up a tower in these areas. And there's small populations or spread out populations that make it particularly challenging. And these are probably the folks that need access to cell networks for these types of programs more than others. So I've actually got a project going on where we're bringing low-cost cell networks to remote communities in the Philippines by partnering with a startup out of Berkeley that essentially developed a low-cost cell tower, 1/10 the cost of the traditional towers, but provides the same service. And we can go bring these out by working with folks at the University of the Philippines into remote communities. And now from a research perspective, it's exciting because we're randomizing where we put these towers. So we get to see what the impacts are on socioeconomic status, but also from sort of a more development perspective, we're gonna be able to carefully measure willingness to pay and what the market is in these areas for these cell towers and essentially make a pitch to telcos that they should buy these cheap towers and go out to these areas and connect the rest of the world. And so that's sort of an exciting thing that I think is important to not forget as we're working on these challenges that there are some people that are still left out and how can we address them. With that, I've got one extra minute, but that's all I've got. So if anyone has any questions, feel free. Otherwise, feel free to follow up. I'm around in general, so you can send me emails if you want to meet or ask me questions. Thank you.
I forgot to highlight your Twitter.
Oh, right. So Price School is great at social media. I appreciate that. So my Twitter account is here, and here's the Center for Social Innovations. I haven't been looking at it as much since the elections, but if you tweet at me, I'll notice. With that, thanks.